Okay, so today our speaker is Ivan Frolov, and he will tell us about Kuiper's theorem. Ladies.
Hello. Is my screen visible?
Yes, yes.
Okay, so I would like to tell about Kuiper's theorem, which states that a group of invertible operators on the separable infinite dimensional Hilbert space is contractible. But first I would like to remind some facts about finite dimensional spaces. So the group of invertible matrices over R is homotopy equivalent to the orthogonal group by Gram-Schmidt process. And the group of invertible matrices over C is homotopy equivalent to the group of unitary matrices. And it is well known that P0 of orthogonal group consists of two elements with depending on the sign of the determinant, and P1 of the unitary group is isomorphic to Z. And had the facts are the following. The homology of the unitary group with coefficients Z is known, and it's isomorphic to the exterior algebra on generators in degree 1, 3, and n-1. Where this is exterior algebra. Where the degree of x to I minus 1 is equal to 2i minus 1. Okay. And there is a famous theorem of Bode called Bode periodicity, which states that if U is the direct limit or just disjoint union of unitary groups for n goes to infinity, then double suspension of U is homotopy equivalent to U, and so the homotopy groups of U are known, they are zero for even degrees, and they are isomorphic to Z for odd degrees. And there is an real analog of this theorem, which states that if O is a direct limit of orthogonal groups, then if you take the loop space 8 times, then it will be isomorphic of the orthogonal infinite orthogonal group, then it's homotopy equivalent to the orthogonal group. And the, so the homotopy groups of all are also known. I will not describe them here. So it is somewhat surprising that for a Hilbert space, everything is different. So let H be a separable Hilbert space, infinite dimensional. Then Kuiper's theorem states that proved in 1964 states that the group of invertible operators on H is contractible. In particular, we have a proposition that homotopy groups of GLH are all trivial. And Kuiper's original proof first proves that the homotopy groups are trivial, and then deduces that the group is contractible. I will now try to explain how to prove this theorem. So suppose we have a map F to be F zero from the nth dimensional sphere to the group of invertible operators on the Hilbert space. And we will produce a sequence of homotopies such that other F0 is a given map, and after a sequence of homotopies, we'll obtain the trivial map. How can I introduce a new page? Okay, so we have a map F0 from the nth dimensional sphere to GL of H, equipped to the norm topology. And first lemma is that there exist F1 homotopic to F0 such that the image of F1 lies inside a finite dimensional subspace of endomorphisms. So the endomorphisms are denoted B of H. W is a finite dimensional subspace. Now, proof. We know that GL of H is open in the group of endomorphisms of H. So for every point X in GLH, there exists a ball of some radius epsilon with center X, which lies inside J of H. P epsilon of X is a ball of radius epsilon. In P of H. So the image of sphere and the map of zero is compact. So it can be covered by finitely many such balls. So it lies in a union. And then the sphere is covered by inverse images of these balls. And here we may think of the unit sphere as the boundary of n plus one dimensional simplex. So if we have a open cover of the of a simplicial complex, then we may take a barycentric subdivision of this simplicial complex. Division of the simplicial complex sufficiently many times. So that after barycentric subdivision, every simplex of the resulting simplicial complex lie in one, in the preimage of one ball. So we get a simplicial complex. Say K, which is of course homeomorphic to the sphere, such that every simplex of K lies in the preimage of one balls. Now, we know that f0 of every simplex, so every simplex, say delta, lies in the preimage of some balls, so f0 of every simplex lies in one ball, and the ball is convex. So there is we may choose a map F1 from we can define the map F1 to be linear on every simplex. So we obtain a map defined on the whole simplicial complex K. And by convexity of the ball, since all vertices of on vertices, the map F1 equals to F0. f1 equals f0 on vertices. By convexity of balls, the image of F1 lies inside the GL of H. All operators in the image of K are invertible. And also by convexity, there exists a linear homotopy between F0, F1. So Ft of, say, point K equals to T F1 of K plus 1 minus T F0 of K. And this is a homotopy between F0 and F1. This completes the proof of the lemma. Now, first of all, consider special case. Suppose there exists an infinite dimensional subspace H0 in H such that F1 restricted to H0 is the identity map of H0. And H0 is infinite dimension. I claim that in this case, there exists a homotopy between F0 and the identity. The identity map is, of course, the map which maps every point of the sphere to the identity operator. So we may decompose H as a direct sum of F. We decompose H as an orthogonal sum of F, H0 and H1. And every map of every element of GL of H, or even every bounded operator on GL of H, can be represented as a matrix. I'm sorry, is the background noise too loud? Or not?
Well, I don't hear any noise.
So okay. It's great. So we decomposed H as a direct sum, and we know that F1 is the identity operator on H0. So the matrix is like this, and some matrices here. So there is a homotopy. Well, if such operator is invertible, then right bottom corner contains an invertible element of H1. So we might take a linear homotopy, which will, well, it looks like this. T, which will deform the right top corner of the matrix to zero. So in the end we will get a matrix of the form identity 0, 0 and some element of some invertible operator on J of H1. So here the sequence of pictures, the sequence of pictures when obtained F2 such that F2 restricted to H0 is the identity operator of H0 and F2 maps H1 into H1. Now we'll use a trick which requires H0 to be infinite dimensional and does not work for finite dimensional space. So we say that H0 is isomorphic to an infinite sum of orthogonal sum of H1. And relative to this decomposition, I will write the matrix of F2. So I will need to change the summons. Now H is H1 plus H0 and H0 is a sum of infinitely many copies of H1. So relative to this decomposition, F2 is an operator of the form some map G on H1. This G is an element, an endomorphism of this space and identity operators in other places. This is an infinite matrix. There is a well-known fact that matrices of the form A, B, 0, 2, this is a 2 times 2 matrix, is conjugate to the matrix, which change diagonal entries. And moreover, there is a homotopy between. There is a path between such matrices, which depend continuously on A and B. More precisely, I think I need to create a new page. So we know that F2 is an infinite matrix, which has G in the top left corner and identities the diagonal and zeros everywhere else. By the way, entries of this matrix are elements of J of H1, they are not numbers. And I started to say about a path with I started to say something about how to change diagonal entries in 2 not 2 matrix. And this is done as follows. We conjugate the matrix AB by matrix, by rotation matrix. Here A and B are elements of J of H1, and T is a number between 0 and pi over 2. So this product equals AB if T equals 0 and BAR changed if T equals pi over 2. So we say that F2 is a product of J J identity, J identity, so on, times J, J minus one identity, J minus one identity, so on. Now we conjugate the left matrix by a rotation matrix as we did here. And in this way, we obtain a homotopy between F2 and say S3. So we obtain a homotopy with F3. In F3, we every 2 not 2 matrix, we change the diagonal entries in every 2 not 2 matrix. And the second multiple remains the same. And this product equals to J, J minus one, J, J minus one, and so on. And we do the same trick again. This matrix is a product of J1, J1, and so on. One is there. By one, I mean the identity times identity J minus one, identity J minus one, and so on. We group this together in two not two blocks, and we obtain that F3 is homotopic to F4, where F4 is identity J on the diagonal, is a diagonal matrix of the form identity J, and so on, times the second matrix remains the same, J minus one, and so on. And this product is just the identity. So, 4 is just the identity matrix. And we proved that F2 is homotopic to identity. This, I want to remark that this proof does not work for I'm creating a new page, I guess. This doesn't work for the direct limit of unitary groups because in the process of when we did the homotopy, there was a matrix. There was a sequence of 2-2 matrices, of rotation matrices, where each 2-2 block is cosine t sine t. And this this infinite matrix does not belong to the direct limit. Okay. So what remains? Another lemma, 3, which states that if F is an arbitrary map from the sphere to GL H, such that the image of F, such that the image of the sphere lies inside a finite dimensional subspace of operators, then there exists another map, say F prime homotopic to F, and in infinite dimensional subspace H0 in H, such that F prime restricted to H0 is the identity map of H0. So to prove this lemma, well, if we approve this, then by lemma 1, we can deform an arbitrary sphere to a sphere which image lies in a finite dimensional space W, then by lemma 3 we will create an infinite dimensional subspace H0 such that well, by F restricted to H0, I mean that for every point inside the nth dimensional sphere, the operator F of X is an operator. It lies in GL of H. And this operator maps H0 to H0. And it is identity on H0. This is what I mean by restriction F to H0. So if we can find, no, this is, sorry, this should hold for f prime. If we can do that, then by previous lemma, lemma two, I guess, there is a homotopy between f prime and identity map. So now I'm going to prove this lemma. We take an arbitrary vector A1 in H. Since the W applied to A, this is just a set of all W small a one, one W small runs through W big. This is a finite dimensional subspace in H. By the way, its dimension is not greater than the dimension of W, which I will denote by M. So then there exists a subspace A1 in H, which contains the vector A1 small, contains W A1, and the dimension of A1 is equal to M plus 2. Then there exists another vector, say B1 in the space A1, which is orthogonal to A1 and to the space W1. Since the linear span of vector A1 and the space WA1 has dimension at most m plus 1. And then we continue by induction. We can find a vector A2 such that it is orthogonal to the space A1 and W, and for every W small and W big, W A2 is also orthogonal to the space A1. This is possible because since W big is finite dimensional, this is a finite set of linear equations on A2, and in the infinite dimensional Hilbert space H, finite system of linear equations has a solution. So such vector A2 exists, then there exists a space and A2, which contains A2, which contains W applied to A2. And such a dimension of A2 equals 10 plus 2. And again, we choose a vector B2 in A2 orthogonal to W A2 and orthogonal to A2. So in this way, we obtain a sequence A Y of finite dimensional subspaces. So the dimension of every such space equals n plus 2. In every space, we have there are pairwise orthogonal. I'm sorry, here I should assume that A2 is orthogonal to A1. So we find the sequence AE of subspaces, all of the same dimension, pairwise orthogonal, and in every space, a vector AI. And BI such that BI is orthogonal to AY, BI is orthogonal to WAY, and BY lies in AY. And we can, moreover, we can assume that all these vectors have unit length just by norming them. Okay, and now I don't have enough space to write. Okay, so I'll create a new page and write again what we have. We have a sequence AI of spaces that are pairwise orthogonal. The dimension of every such space is n plus 2. In every space, we have vectors AY and BY of unit length. And WAY AI lies I. AI is orthogonal to BI, WI is orthogonal to BI. Okay. Now we had a map F. Sorry. From the n dimensional sphere to linear group such that for every point in the sphere, the operator f of x lies in W. And we will construct a homotopy between F and some F prime such that F prime sorry, can you see the screen? Okay, such that for any point x in the sphere, the operator f prime of x is the identity on the space spanned by AI, by vectors AI. So if H0 is a span of closed span of A1, A2, and so on, then H0 is infinite dimensional and F prime will be identity on this space. And to produce such a homotopy, first we will construct a homotopy F, homotopic to say G, such that G of A Y has unit length for all I. Well, to do that, we just say that G G is a composition of F and H, where H H is a diagonal operator. It is AI divided by the norm of AY, and H is the identity when restricted to orthogonal complement H restricted to the orthogonal complement of the space spanned by vector say I. H is the identity there. And of course, the there is a path between H and the identity operator. So there is a path between H and identity. Well, just HT of AY equals to is T AI plus 1 minus T AY over epsilon, or the norm of AY. And F HT is a homotopy between F and J. So now we may assume that J of AI has unit length for all I. Now for any point X in the sphere, F of X is an operator on H, and it maps the vector A1 to AI we replaced F by J. So this is J of X applied to I is a vector of unit length, and it is orthogonal. It lies in, it is proportional to A, so it lies in the space AI, and it is orthogonal to BI. So we will rotate, we will take the plane generated by JX, JFX applied to AY and BI, the span of two such unit vectors is a plane, and we consider a rotation in this plane. So this is an operator which acts as a rotation of this place, and to him we can continue it to the whole H in the following way. This operator is the identity on the orthogonal complement to this plane inside AI. So in this way, we obtain an operator G prime such that for any X in the sphere, G prime of X applied to AY equals BI. And this is a homotopy between J and J prime. And now.
Sorry, is it okay with, is all right with H? Does it depend on X? Well, your AI, there were unit vectors, is it, actually?
Yes, AI and BI unit vectors.
So, but when you divide again, so, but it, maybe just identity map. When, why are you dividing by the norm? They are one, and where is X? Does it depend on X or?
X, well, this plane in which we rotate it, this plane, it depends on X.
I'm asking about H. Is it all right with H?
H, small h?
Yes, small h.
I think it does not depend on X.
Yes, but norm of AI is one, so it's, in that case, it's just identity map, is it?
Yes, sorry. I wrote something.
Probably, maybe norm of g of x of ai when you're dividing not by ai. Yes, this one.
Yes, thank you. Here it should be j, norm of j of x to ay. And it does depend on now. Okay,
it does depend on X, is it? H as well, by somehow.
Yes. But it depends continuously on X.
Uh-huh. So H depends on X. Okay.
Yes.
Okay, thanks. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay. And now we make another rotation, this time on the plane spanned by A1, AI, and BI, such that, here J maps G of X for every X, J prime of X. Maps AI to BI, and we make a rotation and obtain G double prime, which is homotopic to J prime, and such that G2 of prime of X applied to AY equals AY for every X. So we make a rotation. In this plane. Actually, we need to verify that this homotopies depend continuously on X and T and uniformly in A, but I probably. They will omit this verification. And so this completes the proof of lemma 3 and of Kuiper's theorem. So in this way, we proved that homotopy groups of JH are zero. Now I will say something about how we deduce from this the fact that the group GL of H is contractible. Now proof that GL of H is contractible. We can find a covering of GL of, since GL of H is an open subset in the Banach space P of H, we can find a cover of GL of H by balls. This time the union is infinite, balls of radius epsilon I with center. This centers say Ti. We may also assume that the ball for every I, the ball with radius 3 epsilon I with the same center lies inside GL of H. So for every point we can find such a ball. So of course this is true. And now GL of H is paracompact. Well, I don't know an easy proof of this fact, but it follows from the fact that every metric space is paracompact. So we may find a partition of unity subordinate to this covering. So we find a sequence of functions phi I from J to R such that it is a partition of unity. And the support of every function, let's denote it by vi, support of phi I. The set of such of points x and j such that fi of x is not zero, is greater than zero. This sets Vi form and also form an open cover of GL of H, but this cover is locally finite. And of course, phi is greater or equal to zero and the sum of phi is identity. Then we can take the nerve of this cover. It's a finite nerve of the cover in VI. It's a simplicial complex, infinite simplicial complex. With vertices corresponding, but BI corresponding to sets on our open cover, and there is a simplex B A1 B A K. There is a simplex on these vertices. If the intersection of the eyes is not empty. And we can, well, since this is a simplicial complex, then every map M to G of H by what we already proved is null homotopic. Because my contracted by induction of the on dimension using the fact that well, the boundary of the simplex is a sphere, and the map from sphere to GL of H is null homotopic, so we can extend the homotopy to simplex of high dimension by induction. So it remains to factor the map, the identity map GL of H on GL of H up to homotopy through okay. The map from GL of H to N that would be psi is defined as follows: psi of x is the sum for I of phi of x times times ti, where yes, where ti is our centers of the poles that we chose. I apologize. This is a map from GL of H to N. So BIs are vertices of simplices in N. So the map is defined by in this way. And the map from N to GL of H, it maps every vertex BI. This map, let it be, I don't know enough letters, H, it maps BI to the center of the ball and is extended by linearity. And then the assumption of that the balls with radius 3 epsilon a with sanctity I lies in general h, together with the fact that balls are convex, imply that the composition of psi and phi is homotopic to identity. We can just take a linear homotopy. So J of H is contractible. It follows from this fact that the unitary group, not U at M, but the unitary group, the group of unitary operators on H is also contractible. It is a normal topology. Well, this is true because there is a retraction from GL2. From GL of H to U of H. And the retraction is provided by polar decomposition. So every operator, if A is any operator, then there is polar decomposition. A equals U times A star A to power minus 1/2. Well, I confused the order. Maybe it should be A star, sorry. But there is a polar decomposition. And if A, and here U is unitary, and A star A to power minus 1/2 is self-adjoint. And if A is unitary, then U coincides with A. And so A map, the map which assigns U to A is a retraction. The retract of a contractible space is contractible. Okay. I still have enough time.
Well, I'm sorry, probably we must take just the square root of A star A here. I mean, in the formula for the polar decomposition. Okay, thank you.
Oh, maybe I will tell without proofs about some results. About J of X, the group of invertible operators on some Banach spaces. x. It was proved by a theorem. By Doa G, I don't know how to pronounce this correctly, 1965 states that if x and y are Banach spaces such that every operator from x to y is compact and x and y are isomorphic to the hyperplanes, so x is isomorphic to a hyperplane in x, and the same is true for y. Xy isomorphic to the hyperplanes. Then J of x times y is homotopy equivalent to J of x times J of y times z times this is called the classifying space of the unitary group for the complex case or orthogonal group for the in the real case. For example, this is true if x is LP, y is LQ, and P is greater than Q. P is less than infinity and Q is greater or equal to 1. This result is not trivial, but it's easy to see that that the group of invertible linear operators on x times, let's say P times LQ is not connected. Because every element in every such operator is a matrix of the form ABCD, where C is a bound linear operator from LP to LQ. And so it's compact. It follows that the operator A, B, 0, D is Fredholm, because it's a difference between invertible operator and compact operator. Uh, So this implies that A and D are also Fred Hall. A is an operator on LP. D is an operator on LQ, and they have Fred Hall. And the index depend continuously on them. So if we have a path between two operators of this form, then the index of A and index of T are invariant. So this proves that, well, and of course there exist again, I'm sorry. Okay, maybe I'm confused, so maybe it's time to finish.
Okay. Okay, thank you. Are there any questions or comments?
We considered last example, yes, and we have, according to theorem above, we have there is also classifying space appears. And,
sorry, I didn't hear the question.
How can look the classifying space for example?
Well, the classifying spaces, as far as I understood, it's always the same. It's the the classifying space of the unitary.
It's fixed, yes.
Fixed.
Mm-hmm. More questions, please. Okay, if there are no more questions, then we thank the speaker again. Thank you, Ivan. Most probably next week, we will have a talk by Monica Cabria, and she will tell us something about Kaufman's invariant of knots and its relation to quantum groups.